Good morning, everybody. Welcome behind the scenes here at Jamie Ridler Studios. I am Jamie, and it is Tuesday, and it is almost Halloween. It's tomorrow Halloween, and I'm so looking forward to it. It's a big holiday here at our house. We treat it like a major family day. We feast, we hang out with each other, we watch scary movies, though I always say not too scary because I'm the one who can't take it. And we just have a really fun, relaxed day. We've been doing that ever since Justin and I first started dating, and I was living with Shannon at the time. We were living in a basement apartment, and it was a freezing cold Halloween, and it was freezing cold in our apartment. We had almost nothing, but we tucked in, we bought a pumpkin, and we carved it into one big eye, and we still call it the eye. And we watched movies all day long with the eye watching over us. And it was such an amazing, amazing time that it became a tradition. What are you doing for Halloween? Are you going to a party? Have you gone to a party? Did you dress up? Did you think about your costuming? I'll share an article that I wrote several years ago about how costuming can impact our everyday. I just pulled out my cat ears today because most of my witch hats and wings are ready for storage, but these I had handy. As well as Halloween, I am thinking about our art and our needs and when we're at this stage to share, and relationships and money. So, you know, just some light things. But I'm thinking about when we are at the stage where we want to share our work and when we want to share our work and ask for money in return. Because I know this is a dream for so many of us to make our living at some kind of creative work. And I want to encourage you to pursue that path if that is what's deep within your heart. But I'm going to talk to you about the earlier stage. I'm not going to talk to you about setting prices or owning your value or all of those wonderful things. I'm going to talk to you about where we need to be as a creative in order to share our work with freedom and strength and confidence. And this is going to be a funny thing to balance with the kind of don't wait till you're ready argument, which I agree with. We can spend so much time planning that we don't actually get around to doing, or all the learning that we need to know next is in the doing, is in the messing up and learning, is in the success and seeing what works, is in the getting out there. So learn so much by the doing. But there's something that matters in the early stages of something that you're creating with the hopes of sharing it. There's the professional level. Here I have this thing and I want to share it in the world and I hope that someone will love it and in return they will pay me money and then I'll be able to make more things and then share more things and more people will buy it and then I'll be able to make more and this becomes a business. But there's also this personal level when it comes to our art. We're not so distant or separate from our art. This is not always as transactional as selling, let's say, tires might be. Though maybe somebody is very attached and feels a great deal of love for selling tires. And in part, that's because we are often starting from a place where we are fresh and new and tender and looking for reassurance about ourselves and our art. And it's often a too tender place to start our business on. When it's still about what we need, that's a difficult time to be in the practice of selling our art. Now, I know you might be saying, Jamie, but I, of course, if you have a business, you have to be taking care of your needs. Of course, I want to pay my rent and I'd like to do it through selling my work. Awesome. Yes, absolutely. But when it's this need inside of us, this hunger for recognition, for acknowledgement, for reassurance that our art is good, we may be too early in the game. There may be other things that we should be doing to fill our well before we step out there into a world where, in that transactional world, the person who is buying your art, it is not their job to take care of you. It is not their job to choose your piece of work because they want to make sure you pay your rent. And when you're sitting there hungry for your rent, while they're looking at their art, it creates a different energy. A lot of us, and I include myself, who have been hard on business, are hard on business because we feel like, from a capitalist perspective, that business is trying to get the most from us while giving us the least. And it's also my job as a consumer to get the most for the least. As sensitive, creative people trying to do and move well in the world and maybe do some good here and there, that's probably not the model that inspires us. Generally, we want to be thinking a little bit. We want to be benefiting. We want to be blessing the purchaser of our artwork. And just like in any relationship, it is harder to do that when you are in such need that you really can't get beyond thinking of yourself. And let me just say, that's okay. That's a normal part of the process. There, you must take care of yourself. That's your job. You must fill your well. You must satisfy your creative expression. And so often when we just start in our art, we move directly to how can I turn this into a business? And it's too soon. It's too soon for lots of reasons. One, we haven't lovingly tended our art long enough for it to sustain a business. You know, we've got this little sapling and we're saying, hey, I'm gonna sell some lumber, baby. And it's like this poor little sapling is going, huh? I just started. And often, we do this because we feel like if we're making money at it, it will justify our ability to do it. So we can't justify, we've taken on board that idea that doing something for ourselves is not of value enough that we can set a boundary around it and say, hey, I'm doing this. I'm doing it because I want to do it. I'm doing it because I feel called to do it. That doesn't have enough weight. That's too hard for us to defend. But we can defend, hey, I'm doing this to make money. I'm doing this because it's going to bring some money in. Because that everybody gets that. We all need money. We all need to pay our rent or our mortgage. We all need to buy food. We all need to buy clothes. So we get that. And suddenly, that's the defense for our artwork. I'm going to make money. But the thing is, it's like putting this pressure on that relationship between you and your art before it's ready. This is not the same as needing your work to be master level. This is not you needing to be Picasso. This is not about feeding your inner perfectionist. It's not that. It's about tending to the heart and soul of your creative work. If you are a creative spirit, if you're a creative being in this world, and if you're here and you're still listening, I know that that's you. When you're ready to share the work, and I call that performance, so practice is developing your relationship with yourself using creativity. And then projects is when we start moving into developing a relationship with the work. Right? Now I'm going to start making paintings. Now I'm going to start creating a series. Now I'm going to write short stories. Now I'm going to create a collection of poems. And then performance is when we start feeling like, okay, now I'm ready to share it with other people. And each of those things is relationships. First is my relationship with myself. The second is my relationship with the work. And the third is my relationship with other people. And they build one on each other. If we skip a step, we end up putting undue pressure, and feeling the need from the earlier stages informs deeply what's happening at the end. So for example, if we have built our practice, we know who we are as a creative, we know this is a part of our lives, and we feel nourished, our soul feels, this is not about satisfying our ego. This is about filling our well. This is about moving our muscles. And then we've created things and we have a sense of what we've created. We have a relationship. We understand what that thing is. We understand what it wants to be. And we have together brought something to life. And then we offer it out into the world. We already have this sense of confidence, like, look, I know who I am and I love this work and I'm ready to share it with the world. And my hope is that people love it, but whether they do or whether they don't, I love it. I love this work. Whereas if we haven't built that relationship, then people's reaction becomes very oppressive. If people love it, the work is good. I am good. If people don't love it, the work is bad. I am bad. Dangerous. This can stop you from creating. This can shut you down. This can be a major blow to your creative life. It is always hard when people don't like what you create. It is. It's always wonderful when people love what you create. But if the main relationship is between you and you, and then you and the work, then you can sustain that. And then you can build that relationship with other people with great love and honesty and truth, because you are rooted in the love and honesty of truth of who you are as a creative and of the work that you, with so much love, brought into being. When we put all our attention on sharing with others, and so this happens if we are a professional, we're sharing with others, we want to give them what they want, we're working really hard, and then we start dropping our own practices, right? We stop dropping our own creative expression, and we're only creating from the impulses of what we see other people might want. Like, everybody wants birds this year. I'm going to make birds. I'm going to do birds. Yep, I'm going to do that. Or if we, let's say we do something like, we love writing short stories, and because we're a good writer, we've become a copywriter, and we edit for other people. And so that becomes, we feel like, well, it's still in the world of words. And so that's great. I'm getting paid for what I love. And then we start getting dry inside. We start feeling our well just dwindling. And we start losing our energy around the work we're doing. And we start despairing about making a living in our writing. And maybe this will be fine, but this needs to be filled. And so we need to go back to reading books we love. We need to go back to writing poetry. We need to go to an open mic night and share our words. We need to remember who we are as a creative spirit, not just as a creative worker. So this is lots to think about, and I'm just touching lightly on each of these topics. And the main reason being is that I don't want you to be discouraged. And I absolutely want you to build a creative entrepreneur adventure if that is what's in your heart. I absolutely want that for you. I want you to be selling your postcards and teaching your classes and selling paintings and running workshops and retreats. I want that for you. And that's exactly why I'm saying start with building a creative practice. Be in integrity as a creative by being creative as a part of your life. Start building a relationship with your artwork. Fall in love with one another. And then start sharing with others. I know not everybody is on the road to creative entrepreneurship, but these three stages of practice, projects, and performance matter to us all, because we will still, and especially with certain art forms, we will still want to, we'll want to make holiday cards and send them out. We'll want to cook a Halloween feast. We'll want to put on a costume and go to a party. And so the stronger our well is filled here, the more in love we are, the more we've built a strong relationship with what we've created, the more we can share with generosity and freedom and light, and the better that is for all of us. And so building the foundations, creating, and then being able to shine and share and be open to relationship through our creativity with others is a profound and beautiful thing that is available to everyone. I think I was inspired by the talk of purpose we had last week and the pain of pushing our spirit into finding a calling that is just right and that looks like a job. And I wanted to deepen and further that discussion by talking about our relationship of art and money and transaction and offering and others. And there's lots of wonderful ways to do that when we can truly offer from our heart. One of the things that I'm getting ready to offer, I think, from my heart is the Studio Yearbook, which is becoming available on Thursday for the winter season. On Thursday, it's available only to early bird subscribers. So I'm going to leave a link. If you're not an early bird yet, run on over, get yourself signed up, because we only have 100 physical copies to send out, and they always sell out during the early bird period. So you'll want, if you're interested in a hard copy, be sure to do that. And even if you want to get it as a PDF and print it for yourself, it's still worthwhile, because during that time period, if you purchase in the first 48 hours, you get a bonus, which is a guided meditation to each of the full moons through the winter. So the full cold moon, the full wolf moon, and the full snow moon. And that guided meditation will help you dig deep and feel into your heart as you create your dream board, which is one of the activities in your Studio Yearbook. One thing that's really special too about the winter yearbook is, we were working on the proof copy, is you come to a section which is called Crossing the Threshold from 2018 to 2019. So unique to the winter yearbook is a section for wrapping up the year that's passed and stepping powerfully and with vision into the year ahead, including identifying your focus areas, the areas that you find really important that are going to guide you through the year, and creating little vision boards for each of them. This is something I do as vision cards. I'm going to do it this year in my yearbook. I can hardly wait. So there's lots of goodies. It really does take you through a season in a way that has you paying attention to your creative heart and also connecting to the season around you, finding the magic in the everyday. It's an invitation to live more creatively, to observe the world from your creative eyes, to nourish your creative heart, to be connected to that energy. And so here's my last year's winter yearbook. It's kind of hilarious. We have a plastic cover to protect it. And this year, you can't really see it, but I put glitter and sparkle all over it for snow. And then all the winter when I used it, it was like against the plastic, which totally, totally made me laugh. And it's just become this wonderful, beautiful reminder of this season of my year. It's filled with memories. It's filled with thoughts. I'm like, oh, that was when we went to Punta Cana. It's filled with my drawings. It's filled with my memories. It's filled with my plans. And when I look at it, it makes me so happy. And it brings me back to last winter. I'm very excited to see where my new Studio Yearbook will guide me in the new season. And I hope you'll join me on the adventure. When you sign up, you also get access to a Facebook group. So there's opportunity to share what you're creating. There's lessons to teach you how to use the yearbook. It's an experience. It's not just paper. It is an experience. One I hope you'll join me for. Have a wonderful Halloween. I hope that you get up to some goodness. I hope you feast and costume yourself and celebrate this really magical time. And I look forward to seeing you on Friday. Bye, everybody.